Hi friends, trying my level best to be connected with you, but because of some technical problem, this video is getting disconnected. Still, I'm trying my level best to finish this video, but yet it has not started even. So the today's topic is writ jurisdiction and various concepts and notions related to this jurisdiction. As there are two articles under the Constitution of India, one is 32 and another is Article 226 of the Constitution of India. And in the wording of great Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, Article 32 is the heart of the Constitution of India. Why he must have said like that? Because there is a proverb in law which is popularly known as ubi just ibi remedium. Where there is a right, there is remedy. Means there can't be a right without remedies. So the remedies are provided to the people. Remedies are provided to the people, litigants who will go to the Honorable High Court and Supreme Court, who will knock the door of the Honorable High Court and Supreme Court. Unless the remedies are provided to a persons, provided to the people at large, then the rights have no value, because rights without remedies are of no value. Therefore, the Honorable great person Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar has said that it is heart of the Constitution of India. Likewise, Article 226 is also a second heart of the Constitution of India, though a body has only one heart, but it is my thinking that it is also like a second heart, because what kind of reliefs can be granted under Article 32? The Honorable High Courts under writ jurisdiction under Article 226 and under Article 227 of similar writ petitions can be filed before the Honorable or respective. Now, what is the basic difference between Article 32 and Article 226, which I would like to focus here? For violation of the fundamental right of the party or litigant, they can approach and knock the door of Honorable Supreme Court under Article 32. Only for violation of fundamental rights, not for the legal rights. Whereas in case of Article 226, for violation of the fundamental, otherwise need to be interpreted. It means all kind of rights, be it legal or constitutional or any human rights. Therefore, for violation of the fundamental right or legal rights or other rights, party can move the Honorable High Court under Article 226 of the Constitution of India, and it's a writ jurisdiction. Therefore, the scope of Article 226 is broader than that of Article 32 of the Constitution of India. And 32 is narrative. It's small as compared with Article 226. For the reason which I already explained before you. Now, fundamental rights are those rights which have been granted to parties or people under Part 3 of the Constitution of India, right from Article 12 to Article 35. Number of rights have been given, like right of equality before law, right of life and liberty, right of speech and expression under Article 19, right of religion, right of custodial accused, etc., right to minorities, etc., etc. Number of rights have been given under Article 12 to Article 35. 12 says that what is state, who can be a state, because writ petition has to be filed against the state only. State includes central government, state includes state government, state includes local authorities, state include any other companies in which the paid up capital is more than 50%, etc., where the government has control, all are such a state. Local authorities may be municipal corporation, gram panchayat, village panchayat, etc. All the statutory bodies created under the laws are state for the purpose of Article 12. And the writ petition can be filed before the Honorable High Court and Supreme Court against the state only. However, I would like to clarify one thing here. Under Article 361, of the Constitution of India, we cannot make the party Honorable President of India and the Governor of the respective state. Because why? Under Article 361 of Indian Constitution, they have got the immunities. They have got the privileges. They cannot be made as a party to any writ. Though the central government, that is Union of India, or state government and the respective officers who passed the order could be made as a respondent under a writ. Now, the concept of locustanding. Locustanding means the person whose rights got violated only can approach the Honorable High Court and Supreme Court. And no other than him can, on his behalf, can move the court. For enforcing the right of others, we cannot move the court. Therefore, the person whose rights got violated, he need to come to the court, he need to file the petition, and no petition can be filed on his behalf. Now you will ask question, what is power of attorney? That is in civil, because power of attorney can always file a petition right from the trial court to Honorable Supreme Court. Whereas in criminal cases, the no power of attorney will attract. Only the party has to come. Therefore, because court will ask, what's your locus? Otherwise, court will not entertain the petition filed by any proxy person to enforce the right of the others. However, this concept of locus standing is broadened, and the scope is broadened litigation. This is nothing but a writ filed for the purpose of public enforcing the right of the people at large. Therefore, it is called public interest class litigation, public litigation to protect the rights of number of people or community or people at large. Therefore, such a people who are not able to come before the Honorable High Court or Supreme Court, they are not in position to come. Education, poverty or illiteracy or any kind of weakness, like they are blind, they are lamed, they are not in, they do not have sufficient funds, money, etc. to come to the court. On their behalf, the petition can be filed, because to file a PIL is that number of people have been violated and they're not in position to come before the court. They're not in position to knock the door of Honorable High Court or Supreme Court. In that case, any public minded person on their behalf can file a petition in the court. In that case, court will not ask the locus standi. What is the locus standi? Court will not, because the concept is broadened. You have got, and another concept of alternate remedies. When we file the petition in the Honorable High Court under 226 or 227, court will always check whether there is alternate remedy available to that litigant or petitioner. Alternate remedy could be in the form of appeal or revision provided under any statute, which may be a alternate litigation which he could have recourse. The court will always check from their judicial mind that whether the person has exhausted the alternate remedy. Because, for example, if the remedy of appeal was available to him or revision was available to him, he cannot directly jump to the Honorable High Court under writ jurisdiction, so that he cannot burden the Honorable High Court. Already number of cases pending before the Honorable High Court are at large. Therefore, the pendency of litigation will be increasing. Hence, that party is litigant is supposed to exhaust the remedy before the honorable authorities, like appeal is provided before the commissioner or revision is provided under that particular statute before a commissioner or any quasi-judicial authority or before the state government. In that case, unless he exhausts that remedy, he cannot approach the Honorable High Court. However, in exceptional cases like his fundamental rights got violated, if he is challenging the law and the case is so urgent, only the relief can be granted by Honorable High Court only, then in that case, court can relax such a thing. And there are a number of case laws also which says that even if alternate remedies are available to the parties, were available to the parties, he is coming to the Honorable High Court directly was justified by the Honorable High Court. Therefore, but this is exception, because unless you point out that your fundamental rights are violated, unless you point out that the particular provision of the statute is being challenged, unless you point out, you satisfied the Honorable Court that the relief can be granted by only High Court and not by the alternate authority, etc., then High Court will not listen to you, and on the ground of alternate remedies, Court will not listen to you. Court will always say you to exhaust, you are at liberty to exhaust the alternate remedies. So the concept is that when alternate remedies are available, the party is supposed to exhaust that, because the party may think to save the time, party may think to directly go to the Honorable High Court, because court can apply its judicial mind, whereas the judicial authorities, a quasi-judicial authority like ministers or collectors, etc., may not be having that much judicial mind which a judges have. And in his opinion, he might think that the it will be wastage of time to go before the collector or commissioner or the minister concerned, etc. That is not the case, because the alternate remedies provided under the statute that need to be exhausted. For example, in case of Village Panchayat Act, the remedies are provided before the collector, thereafter appeal can be filed before the Honorable Divisional Commissioner, etc. Likewise, in case of Bombay Police Act also, that is also known as the Maharashtra Police Act, for extramment proceeding, the order can be passed by collector or by DCP, that is called SP, and it can be appealed before the state government under Section 60 of the Bombay Police Act. And without recoursing the remedy of appeal under Section 60 of the Bombay Police Act, the party cannot directly go to the Honorable High Court. In exceptional cases, in rare cases, court can listen if you have jumped directly to the Honorable High Court. Therefore, the concept of while filing the petition, this must be bear in mind by lawyer, that alternate, he has to check whether alternate remedies are available or not. Now, law of latches. Latches means, for example, in trial court, when suit is required to be filed, any appeal is required to be filed before district court, or even in the high court, appeal is required to be filed, or any case like case of Negotiable Instrument Act under 138 is required to be filed, then certain limitation is given, timely is given to file any suit, to claim injunction, etc. Some limitations have been given, duration have been given, within which the party is supposed to file his case. And there is a proverb in a law that the court will protect the right of those who are vigilant and not of those who are sleeping or their own rights. So vigilantibus non dormantibus, that is the proverb. They have to come before the court, they have to knock the door of the court in reasonable time. So for appeals and revisions, 30 or 60 days duration is provided. You know, for different cases, it is duration is different. Likewise, in case of writ jurisdiction, the law of latches is applicable. What law of latches says? It is not like a calculation of the mathematics. It is not a rigid and hard and fast rule, like you have not come in 60 days, we will not entertain your writ petition, etc., or you have to come in 6 months. That is not the case. Therefore, days have not been explained, and particular days or months, so there is no such a criteria to file a writ petition. But it says that law of latches says that you have to approach the court in reasonable time. And what could be a reasonable time? It differs from case to case. However, in number of cases, the Honorable Court said that 1 year could be reasonable time, 1.5 year could be reasonable time, even 2 year could be reasonable time. Therefore, you cannot, suppose your right is right got violated in 2010 and you are filing the petition in 2020. You never take any step. You did not do anything. You were sleeping for 10 years and now you are coming to the court. Then after 10 years, court will not entertain your petition on the ground of law of latches. This petition is, such kind of petitions are required to be dismissed. Therefore, law of latches says that you have to come the Honorable High Court or Supreme Court in reasonable time. Though the time is not explained, not defined, But what could be reasonable depends upon case to case. So in based on the experience, I'm telling to you that 1 year could be reasonable, 1.5 year could be reasonable, 2 year maybe reasonable, but you have to satisfy the Honorable High Court that as to why you are coming late to the court and what prevented you from coming to the court, what were you doing, why you are not taking the steps. The reasons must be genuine. Likewise, in case of trial courts to file a case, if there is a delay, then the application for condonation of delay is required to be given along with affidavit, etc. Citing the reason, genuine reason as to why the party could not come or approach the consent court in due time or required time. Same principle is applicable here, but there is no hard and fast rule of days and months, etc. for the purpose of calculation. So it says that only reasonable time. In my case, which I have handled before the Honorable High Court, one of the example. The party's land was acquired by the government. Party's land was acquired. Party's rights land was acquired by the government. Sorry for interruption. I was getting a call from or messages personally. So law of laches, locus standi we have covered, alternate remedy we have covered. Now with withdrawal of the petition. In case of writ petitions, the party who files the petition is at liberty to withdraw the same. It is at his liberty. He, if he wishes so, then he can withdraw the same, because the petition which he filed is claiming to enforce his rights. If he waives his right, then who can prevent him? Therefore, the parties are at liberty to withdraw their petition at any time. It is depending upon their will and wish. However, withdrawal could be by two way. One is by taking the liberty of the Honorable High Court or Supreme Court where the petition is pending, and without taking the liberty of the respective court. What are the consequences if he takes the liberty of the court for withdrawing the petitions? If he withdraws the petition with the liberty, then obviously he can file the petition, similar kind of petition, claiming the same relief thereafter. Therefore, the liberty is given by the court. However, in certain cases, the liberty is not given, for example. Then, what are the drawbacks? If the liberty is not given by the party, in that case also, in my view, there are rights of the parties. And to enforce his right, he can always. But file the petition. It doesn't look good to the sense, because in a filing of the petition, then withdrawing without liberty, then filing attracts the res judicata. There it has got some connection with the res judicata, as explained in our section. Because once you file the petition, that is heard, and if it cannot come to the court once again. However, when the matter is pending, then res judicata will not attract. When the matter is not finally adjudicated by the court, then it will not attract. Res judicata will not attract. Therefore, it is advisable to the parties to take the liberty of the court. However, in some cases, if the liberty is not taken, still party can enforce their right, because if the rights are given by statute or by Constitution of India to that party, then that party can always, based on that rights, fundamental or legal, can always file the petition, and the liberty of the court cannot become a hindrance or obstacle in claiming his rights. Therefore, but most of the time, advocate, they take a liberty after taking instruction from the party, they take a liberty of the court to withdraw the same, and thereafter they file afresh. Sometime now, amendment of the petition. Amendment of the petition. Depends that the claim which they are claiming, if they have not made avernment, they have not taken the grounds, they have not exhibited the documents which are required to be exhibited, which are very necessary, which they have omitted from its being exhibited. In that case, they can always seek a liberty of the court to withdraw the petition so that they can carry out the amendments. They can add the exhibits, they can add the averments, they can change the prayers, etc. Depends upon the case. In that case, the permission has to be sought from the respective honorable courts to amend the petition, etc. Otherwise, they can withdraw the same with the liberty and they can file afresh, or without withdrawing the petition, they can amend the same if they make a prayer to the honorable court interim, as interim relief, they can or even oral request can be made to make the amendment, whereas sometime application is required to be given in the written form along with affidavit, etc., to make the amendment, and after giving the opportunity to the other side, court may allow it, and thereafter within a particular time the amendment need to be carried out. So we have covered the many aspects like remedies, alternate remedies, locus standi, law of laches, withdrawal of the petition with liberty or without liberty, amendment of the petition, etc. Now we shall cover the kinds of writ petitions. As broadly, the writ petitions are classified in two categories. Like from the viewpoint of practice of the lawyers, we say that criminal writ petitions or civil writ petitions, etc. Whereas under the Constitution of India, there are five kinds of writ. Apart from these five kinds of writ, there could be other orders also, because the meaning of the writ is order of the court. Order of the court means writ. So number of orders can be passed by the Honorable High Court and Supreme Court. Apart from these five kinds, there could be other number of kinds of orders also, which are given in the interest of justice, which are issued in the interest of justice. So under the Constitution of India, there are five kinds of writ petitions. Number one is the writ of mandamus. Writ of mandamus means we command. When you file the petition in the Honorable High Court and Supreme Court, then court, it is command of the court. It is positive, something positive in the nature that court commands the authority. When the order is passed by the administrative authority, executive authority like collector, commissioner, or state government or minister, etc., or the order is passed by the lower judiciary, when the directions are given by the court, high court, to the subordinate authorities, when the directions are given to the tribunal, quasi-judicial authorities, executive authorities, judicial, lower judicial authorities, in that case court will give directions like, it's our command, we command you to do this. Means writ of mandamus means the court will direct them to do something which is positive in the nature. When the particular case is not being decided for long, like maybe 6 years, 7 years, 10 years, etc., in that case, to get it expedited, the court, high court, can give directions. You sum up the case, you conclude the case or trial within particular time. That is called writ of mandamus. For another example, your land is acquired by the collector, that is government, through a collector, but no compensation is awarded to you or given to you. In that case, you have to make a representation to the collector or to the state minister, etc., secretaries of the state, etc., and despite of the fact that you have made a representation, request that your rehabilitation should be done as your land is acquired by the government, but still no rehabilitation is done, either in the form of giving job to your family member or giving alternate land to you as a part of rehabilitation. In that case, you can file a writ of mandamus before the Honorable High Court. In that case, court will direct them as to why you have not done rehabilitation. Court will ask them question, and the process of the writ petition will be continued. Like once you file the petition, that will be heard, court will issue the notice, a respondent will appear, they will file their reply. If you wish, then you can file a rejoinder. If the other party feels, then they can file a surjoinder, etc., etc. Thereafter, finally the matter will be heard. But this is writ of mandamus, because in that case the court can give direction to them, court will give direction to them under writ of mandamus only. Another example, for example, writ of mandamus, for example, illegal construction is going on in a locality or throughout the cities, whereas public minded persons have filed, social worker, lawyers, journalists have filed application requesting that the demolition necessary step be taken against the illegal construction which is going or being carried out, or if it is carried out then demolish the same, etc. If no such steps, legal steps, have been taken by the commissioner of the municipal corporation or by competent authority, they have omitted from their doing public duty, in that case always you can file a writ of mandamus. So writ of mandamus is always filed when there is a public authority has omitted from doing its public duty. There is public authority, like municipal commissioner has, he is a public authority, but he failed to perform the public duty. Public duty means here he was required to take some steps, he was required to demolish the construction illegally constructed, or he should refrain the illegal construction which is going on, etc. Then public duty is, there is omission of the public duty by public authority. Public authority may be collector, tahsildar, minister, or anyone. Any person who is holding the public post, government post, did not do his private public duty, did not do his public duty, or did not perform his public duty. In that case, a writ of mandamus can be filed because he has omitted to do his duty. Therefore, when the public authority omits his public duty, in that case, a writ of mandamus can be filed. For example, another example I would like to give you, when cognizable offense has been committed by persons and complaint has been made by aggrieved persons to the police so as to register FIR, and the concerned inspector has not registered the FIR, then the concerned aggrieved person has complained to the DCP, who has also not taken any action. Then the party are at liberty to file a petition under private complaint under section 156 subsection 3 of the CRPC. However, in such exceptional cases also, party can directly come to the Honorable High Court under writ jurisdiction. If the matter is so serious, the offense is so serious, then the party, like a murder has been committed, but still police is not taking cognizance, no FIR is registered, SP is not doing anything, etc. Instead of going to the filing private complaint, directly party will come to the Honorable High Court, but that, because the nature of offense is grave, the matter is so serious, in that case, court will, under a writ of mandamus, will direct the concerned inspector of police to register FIR. And court can also take necessary, Honorable Court can also direct the concerned ministry to take some legal action against the inspector, or stern legal action or appropriate legal action against him in respect of his service, etc. That person, inspector, could be dismissed from his service also. Therefore, the crux of the requirement of writ of mandamus is that when there is a public authority who omitted from his official duty, public duty, in that case, to enforce that public duty, right, party whose rights gets violated can always go to the court under writ of mandamus. Under writ of mandamus, court can give directions to such authorities. Thereafter, the authority, public authority, may be quasi judicial authority, executive authority, tribunal, or subordinate judicial officers, to whom the Honorable Court can give direction under writ of mandamus. Now, second kind of hope that you, I have covered the writ of mandamus meaning and examples also. Now, another kinds of writ is writ of habeas corpus. Habeas corpus or habeas corpus. This writ is also very famous writ. It is also called writ of habeas corpus. When the writ can be filed, against whom it can be filed? Generally, a writ can be filed against the state only as provided under Article 12. However, this is the exceptional kind of writ where a person can file a writ against the private person also. Now, what does mean by habeas corpus or habeas corpus? Habeas corpus means produce the body of that person. Produce that person itself before the court. That is the literal meaning of the habeas corpus or habeas corpus. Produce the body of that person. Produce that person itself in the court. When any person has been illegally detained by the government authority or by private person, in that case, writ of habeas corpus or habeas corpus can be filed before the Honorable High Court and Supreme Court. In that case, court can give directions to produce the body of that person itself. So, person gets illegally detained. Public authority has detained the person illegally. If there is that need to be established, first of all, that the detention is illegal. When the detention itself is illegal, that, for example, the person has committed offense, FIR has been registered, the person has been identified, in that case, obviously, a writ of habeas corpus will not lie or cannot be entertained because the arrest is legal. Arrest is legal, all procedure have been followed. In that case, court will not hear the writ of habeas corpus. The criteria to file the writ of habeas corpus is that the person is illegally detained by public authority like police or some other officers of the government, and maybe by private person. In that case, the detention is illegal, and to release that person, therefore court ask them to produce the person before the court only. Habeas corpus. So the detention is illegal, that need to be demonstrated by the party. And the person who is detained, that person authority will be a respondent. Even that person may be a kidnapper also, private person also, to whom the court will direct to produce the person. And another speciality of this petition is writ of habeas corpus or habeas corpus is, this can be filed not only by a person who got illegally detained, but also by his family member or by friend, because if X person is illegally detained by police, then he will not be in a position to move to the court. Then his family member on his behalf or his friend can move to the court, can file a writ of habeas corpus. So here also the concept of locus standi is broadened. And the definition here, respondents are also, respondent may be a private person also, like even kidnapper can be a respondent herein. And there are also judgments of the Honorable High Court that even in case of missing of the person, writ of habeas corpus can be filed. I did the same thing in my career also. I have handled one case wherein a child of 13 or 14 year was missing. Then we filed a complaint to the police. That child was missing since 1 year, 1 or 2 months. Finally, we filed the petition in the Honorable High Court, and court has appointed a special officer. Thereafter, that boy was found in Mumbai. In that case, no public authority detained him. Only private person detained him. That was the hotelier. So thereafter, necessary steps were taken against that person, etc. So this is special kind of writ where the person is illegally detained by public authority or by private authorities. In such a cases, writ of habeas corpus can be filed, and court will ask them to produce the body of that person, and thereafter court will decide of its that releasing of that person. Court will release that person immediately after hearing the parties. One thing I am forgetting here regarding this writ of habeas corpus, perhaps I'll comment on that later on also. And thereafter I have remembered now, habeas corpus can be filed, for example, under a CRPC. Once the person gets arrested, that accused has to be produced before the nearest magistrate within the span of 24 hours. However, while counting such a duration, the journey time should be excluded. But police have arrested that person, there is no FIR. Police have kept the person in the lodge or private lodge, etc., not in the police station, etc. Okay, it might happen that 3 days have been passed from the arrest of that person, there is no FIR. In that case, the detention itself is illegal. or the procedure, due process of that arrest is not being followed. Like his family members have not been informed. Signatures of two persons while doing arrest is not taken, and he was not told that he in the office that he what are the remedies available to him. He can recourse to his he can take advocate legal advice of his advocate. All such of formalities have been avoided by the police intentionally. It means due process of law is not followed. A writ of habeas corpus can be filed. His detention is illegal because there is no FIR. Another example, if X person has committed offense, but intentionally police have arrested his father and brother who have no role in the offense, etc., whose name is neither appearing in the FIR nor in the nor from the other evidences, etc. In that case, their detention is illegal. And police, suppose they keep the accused in the private lodge, etc., for 1 day, 2 day, 5 days without FIR, or even FIR is there, but they cannot keep the person in the lodge for 3 days, 4 days, 5 days in the either in the absence of FIR or with the FIR also, because they have to produce the person accused within the span of 24 hours before the nearest magistrate, which they fail. In that case, habeas, writ of habeas corpus can be filed. So the conclusion is, under a writ of habeas corpus, that the person by the public authority or by a private person, in that case a writ of habeas corpus can lie. Whereas the case, no writ of habeas corpus can be filed. Apart from this, the person who got illegally detained can also claim compensation from the state for his illegally detained by the state authorities. For example, person was put in the lockup, police lockup for 5 days, etc. There was no FIR, etc. In that case, for even custodial death or injury or for violation of his liberty, he can always seek a compensation from the Honorable High Court. Third kind of writ is writ of quo warranto or quo warranto. Quo warranto means, if any person is holding public office and without possessing the basic qualification or requisite qualification to possess that office, then the writ of quo warranto or quo warranto can be filed against him. Like, under what capacity he is holding that post. For example, to be a collector or deputy collector or to be superintendent of the police, you need to pass the UPSC examination, Union Public Service Commission, etc. Without that examination, you cannot be appointed. For example, assume that the XYZ minister has given the order, biggest person, politician has given the order, and you have been appointed. Nowadays, like directly bypassing the UPSC, number of persons have been given a job of the joint secretary, which is upper than the IAS examination, IAS like collector, etc. Still, petition of the quo warranto are pending before the Honorable Supreme Court. Like, writ of quo warranto can be filed when public office is occupied by the person, chaired by the person who do not have the basic qualification to have that post. He does not have the basic qualification to remain on that post or to hold that office. In that case, question will be asked by the court, under what authority, under which power, under what power you are holding that office. Thereafter, that person can be vacated from the post. For example, a principal of the college cannot be appointed unless he is having PhD, Doctor of Philosophy. However, suppose, for example, the XYZ person is holding the permanent post of the principal without having that PhD. In that case, anybody can go and can file. Student even can file a writ of quo warranto and can ask the question to the court, under what authority is holding that post. Then court will ask the question to the concerned respondent, under what authority is holding that post without possessing the basic qualification. Likewise, the basic qualification, for example, a person is not lawyer LLB, then he cannot appear for the examination of judges. So the basic qualification for him is degree of LLB. Thereafter, he should pass the MPSC examination conducted by MPSC, meant for judiciary. So unless he is having that basic qualification, he cannot be appointed. If he is appointed, then the writ of quo warranto can be filed. Another example I would like to give you. Without any public MPC examination, no judicial officer can be appointed, no tehsildar can be appointed, class 1 officer or class 2 officer cannot be appointed. So in the absence of such examination, if anyone is appointed, then writ of quo warranto can be filed. Suppose the process of examination is back the door, no advertisement is issued by the concerned authority, no interviews were taken, no written examination was taken, and upon the recommendation of someone, minister or any influential persons, the person, XYZ person is given the post of any officer. In that case, anybody can go from the public, means public mandate person can go and can file the writ of quo warranto. And if that person who is holding the post does not have the basic qualification, or he has not passed the competent examination, or due process of examination was not good, or it was challenged, then he has to vacate the post. So any public office is held by public officer without possessing the basic qualification for that, without possessing the necessary qualification, requisite qualification for that, such a officer has to vacate the post. And court will ask question to him, under what authority, what power you are holding that post. This is writ of a quo warranto or quo warranto. I have covered this. Now, writ of certiorari. Writ of certiorari means, generally we read the newspaper, when there is a writ of certiorari, we hear the news in Marathi that the ya adeshanna kotacha kaatar laglela ahe, means Caesar is there, like the order of the particular authority is cut down by the order of the Honorable High Court. Writ of certiorari means when the order, impugned or defective order passed by lower judiciary or by tribunal or by quasi-judicial authorities, executive authority like collector, ministers, commissioners, lower judiciary means all the lower judges, or by tribunal or by any authority, administrative authority, such orders are against the law or impugned or defective. When there is a particular law is not followed, the order is against the provision of the law, or no law is considered, the order is suffering defect, no principle of natural justice have been followed while passing such order, opportunity of being heard is not given to the party, and such orders are passed by the judicial officers and executive authorities or quasi-judicial authorities or tribunal, etc. In that case, the court can set aside the order under writ of certiorari only. And when we file the writ of certiorari, specific prayer need to be made. Prayer has to be there. Interim prayers has to be there, like during the pendency of this particular writ petitions, the order may kindly be stayed. Means that party has to pray for stay of the order, because it may take some time to decide the petition. And final prayer will be to quash and set aside the impugned order, defective order passed by such authorities. Now, when the writ of certiorari can be filed, writ of certiorari can be filed, I have already explained that principle of natural justice are not followed, opportunity of being heard is not given, or the order is passed against the law, or order is passed based on the law, considering the law, but the law is not in existence, or the law does not attract, or is not applicable to the said incident or fact of the case. In that case, apart from this, the writ of certiorari can be filed when the authority who passes the order have jurisdiction or power, but has not exercised the jurisdiction. Correct? When the authority has jurisdiction, but authority has not, that officer has not exercised the jurisdiction, omission of jurisdiction. When the authority do not have jurisdiction, but passes the order, it means there was no jurisdiction vested with that authority, but that authority has exercised the jurisdiction. That is also illegal. And when there was a jurisdiction, but the jurisdiction was exceeded, the authority has transgressed or overstepped, or he crossed the limits, or in Marathi we call it, Hindi, maryada, he crossed the limit. In that case, the writ of certiorari can be filed. So once again, I'll repeat here, the order passed by the judicial authority, quasi-judicial authority or administrative authority or tribunal, when there was no jurisdiction, but the jurisdiction was exercised, when there was jurisdiction, second, when there was a jurisdiction, but it was not exercised, and when the jurisdiction was not there, but the jurisdiction has exercised, and when there was a jurisdiction, but the jurisdiction has not been exercised, means two contrary situation. First of all, there was no jurisdiction, the jurisdiction is exercised. There was jurisdiction, but it was not exercised. Third, the jurisdiction is crossed, transgressed. And when the order is against the law, provision of law, or based on the law which is not in existence, or opportunity of being heard is not given, principle of natural justice have not been followed, in that case, writ of certiorari can be filed. Now, the writ of prohibition. Word itself is suggestive, which says that prohibition means to stop something, refrains from doing something. Under this writ of certiorari, court can direct the authorities to stop from doing something or refrain from doing something. Perhaps the act may be illegal act, or perhaps the due process of law has not been or is not being followed by the authorities. In that case, court can direct to stop the work. For example, demolition is going on, and the demolition is going on by the municipal corporation, which is illegal, or no notice is issued by the authority, no information is given by the authority, like municipal corporation. In that case, the party can approach the Honorable High Court. Instead of filing the civil writ petition in the trial court, party can always go to the High Court under writ of prohibition, and court will, after satisfaction, after hearing the party, if court comes to conclusion that the demolition being done by the authority, municipal corporation, is illegal, or they have not followed the due process of law, they have not issued the notice, or they are not authorized to demolish the same, etc., etc., number of grounds, demolition is against the law, etc., due process is not followed, notice is not issued, opportunity of being heard is not given, in that case, court can prohibit the municipal corporation, refrain the municipal corporation, stop the municipal corporation from carrying out the demolition. And we generally in trial court, we file the petition of status quo, stay order, etc., injunction, etc. Likewise, it is also same thing in the Honorable High Court. It is nothing but like injunction, preventing someone from doing something. Therefore, it is called a prohibition, writ of prohibition. This is something negative in the nature. Court says to them, do not do particular thing, refrain from doing particular thing, etc. The preventive measures, you can say, because before the act is going to be completed by the respondent, you move to the court because he is going to demolish your home, then you approach the court, then it is called a preventive measures. Therefore, in English, we hear better than cure. Prevention is better than cure. Likewise, this remedy is provided under the Constitution of India. I hope that I have covered writ, mandamus, habeas corpus, quo warranto, prohibition, certiorari, and Article 32, as well as Article 226, Article 227 also, in short, and many concepts like locus standi, alternate remedy, law of laches, withdrawal of the petition, withdrawal by the permission of the court or without the permission of the court, and amendment of the petitions, and many more things. Even the laws, I would like to add here, under a writ of mandamus, any law or particular section of the law is found to be unconstitutional or against the provision of law or against the fundamental rights or ultra vires or goes against the object clause of that particular statute, then such a law can be challenged by parties. Anyone can challenge. because the law is applicable to all the people of the state who are called as a subject. Any one public minded person can file the petition and can challenge the law. Under that writ, which is public interest nature, or public in, through public interest litigation, he can challenge the law and can seek a relief from the court to get the law or that portion or section of the law get declared as unconstitutional for its being violative of fundamental rights, or its ultra vires, or it is against the object clause of that statute. In that case, the prayer is in the nature of writ of mandamus only, because we have to get the law declared. It is not like a writ of certiorari. It is like a declaration. Declaration by the Honorable High Court and Supreme Court under its judicial review under Article 226, that the court can declare a particular section of the law to be unconstitutional for its going against the spirit of fundamental rights, part 3, or going against the object clause. It is in the nature of declarative. Therefore, it is, the prayer is like writ of mandamus, which I wanted to focus here. And what remains now, you can ask me a question also. Now we have got good connection through this Facebook, because I'm using internet of alternate mobile number. Therefore, there was no interruption since last 30 minutes. Earlier, initially, I tried my level best to deliver a lecture, but there was some interruption. I have also made many videos pertaining to law, and I have opened my account, YouTube account, audio, video, number of videos I have made, because I have much interest in the law. What I feel here, suppose I would like to share with you. Now we have covered this topic. Now, apart from this, what I share here, feel here, suppose we are doing a work as a lawyer. Now we are getting clients, like 40 clients, 50 clients. We are doing their work only. Suppose we have to work today only, then the entire day will go in that two cases only, especially in Mumbai, because we have to travel, we have to go to the court, we have to come back, then preparation for the next case tomorrow, we have to read our draft, etc. We will be busy. But what society is going to get the benefit from your knowledge? If you have, suppose, gained some knowledge of anything or any field, then at least you should share the knowledge with the juniors. I feel that having experience of around 12 years or 13 years, I always want to share whatever I gained with my junior colleagues and my junior, etc. Whenever I get free time, then I always call them in the hall. Please come here. Today I want to give lecture to you regarding double jeopardy or anything. What is res judicata? Any concept of law, res sub judice, concept of interpretation of statutes, or any constitutional provision, anything. So that's my hobby or habit. I feel enjoyed sharing my knowledge with you. And juniors, they will also get some direction, because nobody generally gets the time to guide them. So they know the way how to go, they know the target how to go, etc. Because some new lawyers may not be having lawyers in their family, like father, mother, or uncle, etc. Likewise, I joined this law field because in my family I am the only lawyer, and nobody was lawyer from my family. It is only my interest because of which I came and entered in this field. Now feeling happy, doing well to be in this field. What I feel here, that the person should be positive, and so that is the beginning. Unless a person is positive, he cannot do anything in his life. Therefore, I remember one proverb which says that person has to be optimist. An optimist looks opportunity in every difficulty, whereas a pessimist looks at difficulty in every opportunity. So being optimist, you should look opportunity in every difficulty. Rather, you should not look difficulty in every opportunity. Hope that you have enjoyed my lecture, and I have covered many things in my short career of this around, because since are you able to listen me? Hope that you have enjoyed my lecture. Probably next time I'll be covering the other topics also. If you want to check my videos, etc., if you want to listen my videos of law, like, then you can go on my YouTube channel. You can watch the same, and you can share with your friends also if you like. Thanks, dear friends. Enjoy the lockdown. Follow the guidelines of the government. Be sincere and law-abiding person. Maintain social distancing. Suggest the guideline. Suggest something which is innovative to the government. How we can tackle the problem of this coronavirus. How we can stop it. Because we are not from the medicine field, etc. Otherwise, we could have done something. We could have invented. We could have tried at least like a scientist. But I do not know anything of this science field, like a doctor, etc. I do not know ABC of that field. Being a lawyer, I have written so many letters to the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Honorable Chief Justice of India, Honorable Chief Justice of Bombay High Court. And I have also written a letter in the form of public interest litigation on 23rd of March 2020, this saying that the medical test of the COVID-19 should be made free of charge to poor persons or to those persons who are living their life below poverty line, not for the rich one. That letter should be treated as a public interest litigation. That letter I have shared on Facebook on 23rd of March. However, the Honorable Supreme Court of India has taken the cognizance on the letter of some other persons. Still, I am happy because the object is fulfilled. A petition in the Honorable Supreme Court saying that private hospitals should be allowed to take the fees of medical test if their patients are able to give. Obviously, we have prayed for only two things, that only poor should be given this remedy, and those who are living below poverty line, they should be given. Rich people, if they are having enough money, then they are at liberty to pay the same. So my letter was that even if the medical test is conducted at private hospital, not only government but private hospitals, then the medical fees of the medical checkup of COVID-19 should be paid by the government on our behalf, means on behalf of the poor people or on behalf of the below poverty line people. That letter was in the interest of public at large, and I do some similar activities sitting at home. Hope that you are enjoying the lockdown and you are reading and following. Thanks that you have given time to hear me. Next time we shall connect regarding another topic. I'll be coming once again before you. Thanks, friend. Okay.